Hello and welcome to NKB lecture series. Myself Nisarg, and we will be going through some portions of statistical mechanics and relativistic quantum mechanics. The books which I am going to refer for relativistic quantum mechanics are Quantum Mechanics by Arul Das, Quantum Mechanics by Venkatesan and Matthews, L.I. Sakurai, Advanced Quantum Mechanics. Whereas for statistical mechanics, mostly we will be going through the books of Landau and Lifitz, Carson Hung, and Patharia. So these are the three books which I am mostly referring for the statistical mechanics, but they are not limited just to this. In this first lecture, I think we will be brushing up or recollecting some concepts of relativity, particularly special theory of relativity, their notations and the mathematical jargons which are useful that we try to discuss in this first lecture. And as lecture progresses, the lecture series progresses, we will be discussing the relativistic quantum mechanics and applications of this relativistic quantum mechanics, particularly to spectroscopy and high energy particle physics will be discussed. So I welcome again you to join this lecture series, where we'll, in the first lecture, as I've said, we'll be discussing some concepts of relativity. Most welcome. So friends, we start our first unit, that is relativistic quantum mechanics. This relativistic quantum mechanics, before we actually start our session, let us recall some of the concepts of relativity. We know in 1905 and then 1912, Einstein has given two theory of relativity. First, which is your special theory of relativity, and second, which is the generalization of this, is general theory of relativity. Basically, special theory of relativity deals with a frame of reference which are moving with constant speed or constant velocity. It is also known as an inertial frame of reference. Whereas this general theory of relativity deals with a non-inertial frame of reference. That is, where the frame of reference which is moving with a acceleration. And in that case, the laws of motion are defined quite differently than in the case of special theory of relativity. This inertial frame of reference is also known as Lorentz frame of reference, because in this case, when you apply the special theory of relativity, Lorentz transformation remains invariant. This invariance property is the important aspect whenever we consider theory of relativity. So these are the two aspects, special theory of relativity and the general theory of relativity, which was put forward by Einstein, that we now try to couple with the quantum mechanics. We in fact restrict ourselves only to special theory of relativity and of course not the general theory of relativity. In fact, till date, the general theory of relativity and the concepts which are involved in this general theory of relativity, they are not able to be combined with the quantum mechanics. And the major reason which scientists and people are thinking is that the special theory of relativity, or the one which is dealing with the Lorentz frame or the inertial frame of references, where all the laws are, physical laws are derived in this first case in flat geometry. That is, there is no curvature in the space and time geometry. Whereas the general theory of relativity, where due to very heavy mass, due to large gravitational effect, the space and time coordinates are curved, and for such a curved geometry, our laws of quantum mechanics are not yet designed, and therefore
We also restrict ourselves only to a first case where special theory of relativity is now combined with the laws of quantum mechanics. But before we start, let us also realize that where this can be observed, or what are the cases where you need to apply the relativistic concepts. There are two ways to understand that, and for that, let us recall the very famous Einstein mass energy relation. So E is equals to delta mc square. If we remember this equation, then we know that the c is the speed of light in vacuum, m is the mass, and this relation is very important in the case of relativistic quantum mechanics. There are two cases where the relativity is to be applied, the concepts of relativity is to be applied. One, when the particle is moving with a speed, say v, which is approaching the speed of light. So when the particle is moving with a very large speed, then its energy will be very large, and therefore ordinarily the non-relativistic classical mechanics or non-relativistic quantum mechanics will not be applicable. This is the first case where the energy is very large and relativistic has to be used. Second scenario, second case is that either, as I've said, that the velocity is large, or second case that your m is very large. Like we have the terrestrial objects or stars having the mass of solar mass or the greater than solar mass. In that case also, as per this equation, we can realize energy is very large. So commonly, to a lower level, we are referring relativity only pertaining to the speed of a particle or a system. But in general, it is this energy whenever is very large, so that the non-relativistic quantum mechanics is not applicable, that we should look for. There are two cases, either V is large or mass is large, both can give you the energy very large. But in the case of quantum mechanics, as we have realized in our elementary quantum mechanical classes, that basically quantum mechanics is dealing with the tiny particles, microscopic particles, electrons, protons, atoms. And in that case, mass is not too large. But still, because of their relativistically high speed, their energy will be large. As a rough estimate, for such a microscopic particles, whenever energy is of the order of, say, giga electron volt or fraction of giga electron volt, then in that case, your non-relativistic quantum mechanics fails to explain the scenario. In fact, we know the very famous laboratory experiment going on, the Large Hadron Collider. The very basic purpose of this collider is to speed up the hadrons, like protons, so that the energy will be of the order of giga electron volt or sometimes tera electron volt. And because of that, your relativity is playing a role in quantum mechanics. This is, of course, not the scenario, because the particles which we are dealing with in quantum mechanics, they are not so massive, but of course they have a very large energy. So this is the case which we are learning, very strict, as I've said, to a special theory of relativity in conjunction with the laws of quantum mechanics, where the particles are very speedily moving, so that their speed is very large, energy is of the order of this, and therefore now we try to devise a new formalism within the framework of quantum mechanical laws to describe such situation. In fact, this is also not a very strange scenario. If I take a very simple example to illustrate the demand of relativistic quantum mechanics, I take an example of proton and electron. Combinedly, they constitute a stable system known as a hydrogen atom. So even in the case of simplest hydrogen atom problem, if we picturize that the central part containing a proton, the nucleus, and in the outer orbit, when electron is revolving at some distance, say r0, then this picture where electron is revolving, if I calculate the force in it, if I calculate the energy of electron, and if I calculate the speed of electron revolving around the nucleus, the speed of this electron is also about 10 to power, only say 10 to power minus 2 speed of light. So it is such a large speed, it's not small speed. And just to understand this example with our ordinary routine problem, I take a rider who is biking with a speed of say around 722 kilometer per hour. Obviously it gives a thrill that one is traveling with a 720 kilometer per hour. But if I convert this in terms of say meter per second, it comes out to be 7200, I think. Yeah, this is the meter, and of course then 3600 for second. So if I convert this, then I can realize that it is only 200 meter per second. As against that, the speed of light in vacuum C is about 3 lakh kilometer per second. This is tremendously very large speed. Correct? So if you compare these two numbers, you can realize that in the case of hydrogen atom also, electron is moving tremendously fast, and we have to devise new laws to encompass such a high speed particles, that is relativistic quantum mechanics. So that's the reason we need to go beyond non-relativistic quantum mechanics. We have to develop a general formalism to deal with such a situation where the speed is very large, and based on that we try to infer different possibilities, that is the unit number one. But before we jump into the deriving mathematical equations for quantum mechanics, let us also recall that some convention in using the units and the symbols that we will be using in this unit. So we first discuss what we call as the natural unit. This natural unit system, sometimes also written as NU, is written in terms of mass. Here in this natural unit system, mass is the fundamental unit. In this case, h cut, h upon 2 pi, h is the Planck's constant, speed of light in vacuum, they are considered to be of unit value, and they are also considered to be the dimensionless. If this is the case, then now we try to write the different physical quantities in terms of this unit system. I start with energy. So energy E, we have just written. So if I write as mc square, and you know that if C is 1, dimensionless, then energy has a dimension of mass. So energies are written in terms of dimension of mass. In quantum mechanics, we also know E is written as h cut omega. Again, h cut, if it is 1, dimensionless, then the dimension of omega is also m. And don't forget, omega 2 pi f, or it is having a dimension of 1 by t inverse. And therefore, if I write the time, then the time has the dimension of m raised to minus 1. So likewise, you can realize that all the physical quantities in relativity is written in terms of natural units, that is in terms of mass. In relativity, it is assumed that the mass is the fundamental physical quantity. Another concept which we are using in relativity is the type of physical quantities. For example, the different physical quantities can be written in terms of different forms, like covariant form and the contravariant form of the physical quantities. But before we go to that, let us also realize that in the case of relativity, space coordinate and time coordinate, they are treated equally. If I denote time coordinate as t and space coordinate as x, y, z, then they are equivalent in the case of relativity. And therefore, unlike our ordinarily three-dimensional Euclidean space, this requires the four components x, y, z, and time t, such a four-dimensional orthogonal space that we define is known as a Minkowski space. It is nothing but a four-dimensional space, orthogonal space. It's like a extension of your Euclidean space with time involved. They are all perpendicular, mutually perpendicular to it. And therefore, now any physical quantity which we write, either position or momentum or energy, they will also be written as a four-component physical quantity. And therefore, in this Minkowski space, now different physical quantities are also defined as a four-component physical quantity. For example, I write one four vector, like a position vector in a Euclidean space, as we write as a x, y, z. Similarly, this is in our three-dimensional space. If I write the same position vector, or we call the four vector, this four vector, if I write as x, then there are two ways of writing this four vector. One, which is known as a contravariant four vector, usually denoted by the superscript, where mu will go as a 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, and 4. There are four components, as I just said. So we can write this quantity as x0. Sometimes this fourth component, the time component, is also denoted by x0. And this three space coordinate, x1, x2, x3, referring to our x, y, and z, and this x0 component that we write as either plus or minus ict, where c is the again speed of light, t the time. We write this four component as ict because to write all the components in the same dimension, because x, y, z are the position, so in order to get the same dimension, this fourth component, some books write as a x0, or some may write as x4, the fourth component that we write as a ICT. And you can see that this component is written with an imaginary term. So basically, this four vector can be written in this form. This is your contravariant form. And another, which we write as a subscript, is known as the covariant form. This, in short, can be written like that ct, and this x, y, z can be written as r, whereas covariant form can be written as ct, but with an alternate sign in the position coordinates. This covariant and contravariant four vectors are interchangeable. You can convert this covariant to contravariant or vice versa. And we know from our elementary mechanics that in order to make such a transformation, you need some transformation matrix. Here we define what we call as a metric tensor. The role of this metric tensor, usually we write this tensor as eta. Then the role of this metric tensor is to convert this covariant form to the contravariant form. Correct? So for example, if I have, say, contravariant four vector, and if it is operated by such a metric tensor, then finally you get the covariant form. vice versa is also possible. If you have covariant form operated by eta, that is metric tensor, then it can convert this covariant matrix four vector to the contravariant. This eta is written like this. One, it's a four component, 4x4 matrix. And role is to transform your covariant to contravariant or contravariant to covariant form. This covariant and contravariant representation are basically showing the opposite Lorentz transformation property. The difference between these two, they show opposite Lorentz transformation. Don't forget, I have just mentioned in the beginning that in the case of special theory of relativity, Lorentz transformation should be invariant. This is the basic requirement imposed while checking the consistency of the equation in the case of special theory of relativity, that whenever physical quantity undergoes Lorentz transformation, it should be invariant. And what is observed, that covariant form and the contravariant form, though they are Lorentz invariant, but they transform opposite to each other. With this idea, now we can go and define the Del operator, the differential operator, in the case of special theory of relativity. Because we know that in quantum mechanics, the equations which we will be deriving, they are involving the differential operator of either the first order or the second order. And therefore, let us develop mathematics of this differential operator in the case of special theory of relativity. So I define my differential operator either with respect to x or y or z, combinedly if I write as a del by del x mu, correct? So this is nothing but if I take mu is 1, then it is del by del x, mu is 2, then del by del x, y, and like that, correct? This can also be written in an abbreviation in a smaller way, that I can write like it is del contravariant. This is a symbol that we usually adopt to write the differential operator, which is in the covariant form, can be written like this. Meaning is that since this is the it's a first order differential equation with respect to all four components. So basically, it says that 1 by IC, del by del t, differentiation with respect to time coordinate, and then we have a three components which are related to x, y, z. Combinedly, I can write as nebula. Don't forget, nebula in our three-dimensional space are nothing but your del by del x, del by del y, and del by del z. So that I can write in short like this, correct? Or you may also write del, instead of this covariant form, you can write now contravariant form, which can be written like this. Obviously, here the sign will change. So the first term with respect to time as it is, but now this nebula operator, space coordinate operator, can be written like this. And if I make a square, again, we need a second order differential equation, something like del square. So this del square operator, which is nothing but the product of this, so I may write del mu and del mu, then this will give you IC square. So it is minus 1 by C square. And then we have del square by del T square. And of course, this is your nebula square. This operator, del square, is also written as a D'Alembertian operator. This is known as the D'Alembertian operator, differential operator. Basically, it's a second order differential operator for four vector or for the four components vector. There is a sign convention we usually follow in relativity. Whenever you have, say, Greek letters like mu or eta or xi, this are referring to the four components, and therefore its value will go like 1, 2, 3, 4. And you know that either you write 4 or some textbook may write even 0. But whenever you write any Latin letters like I or J or K, then that refers to our three-dimensional Euclidean vectors, that is, it refers to X, Y, and Z. Correct? So this is a convention that this Latin letters are reserved for showing the three-dimensional X, Y, Z vector, where this mu, nu, eta, they are referring to the four component vectors. Defining this differential operator, lastly, now we define the scalar product. The scalar product, because we know that in physics, we come across the scalar product very often while defining the different physical quantities. So if I write now two, four vectors like A and B, and if I take a scalar product between them, so A dot B, meaning that something like A, which is written, say, in a contravariant form, and B, if written in, say, covariant form, other way around is also possible. Instead of this, you may write the same thing, A dot B, like a in a covariant form and B in a contravariant form, then this means that you are writing something like, with a metric tensor transformation which we have just discussed, that this can be written like this, A mu B nu, or you may write eta with a covariant form, then it is A nu B nu. Basically, it indicates that it is the dot product between all four components, and therefore I may write like zero component. Instead of zero, you may write even four, no issue. A zero component, B zero component. It's something like our ordinary vector product, say A vector dot B vector, and it has three components X, Y, Z. So it is like AX, BX plus AY, BY plus AZ, BZ. Same way, this is the fourth component, and then remaining three components, instead of writing explicitly like this, I may write like this. Right? So this represents the scalar product between two, four vectors A and B. This can be even position, this can be any physical quantity. This is known as the scalar product. If A and B are equal, then obviously this is the square of dimension of the physical quantity. So if A and B are equal, then this is your A square, and this A square can be written as the square of its zero component minus it is the magnitude square of vector A. Right? So these are the few concepts which we will be using notation wise, concept wise, to derive our quantum mechanical relativistic equation that we try to do next.
I hope you have enjoyed this lecture, and the equations and the notations which we are going to use throughout this lecture series that we try to recollect. If you have any queries, or if you want to give a suggestion, I request all of you to give your comments in the comment section. And if you have liked this lecture, you can subscribe, you can like it, and you can share this with your friends, this lecture. And in the next lecture, we will continue further, and we apply these concepts of relativity to in fact derive the equations, relativistic equations in the quantum mechanics. So Thank you very much for paying your attention and look forward for the second lectures. Thank you all.